Hello viewers, today we are going to discuss the lesson on the human rights, principles, concepts and evolution. The objective of this lesson include understanding the concept of human rights by understanding the meaning and equating them with natural rights, tracing the evolution of human rights from a historical perspective, learning the different characteristics of human rights and the landmark developments in the area of human rights, and finally, to understand the classification of human rights. Now, let us go to the main part of the lesson. The expression human rights refers to the basic rights and freedoms to which all human beings are entitled. Examples of such rights and freedoms which are often described as human rights include the civil and political rights, such as the right to liberty, freedom of expression, the life and equality before the law, and also the social, cultural and economic rights, which include the right to participate in culture, the right to work and the right to education. Human rights, generally speaking, are regarded as those fundamental and inalienable rights, which are essential for life as human beings. As the United States Declaration of Independence, 1776, proudly declared, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that they are endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights, and that among these rights are the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Similarly, they can be compared to the protective gear with which the character Karna was born in the epic Mahabharata. Thus, the human rights are inherent and also inalienable, that is, they cannot be waived generally. They are in a way synonymous with a life of dignity, freedom, and natural rights and fundamental rights. A host of such terminologies have been used at different times in history with different degrees of emphasis, but in ways to reflect one common feature, that is, those elementary rights are considered indispensable for the attainment of an individual's wholesome personality. For an easy understanding, the concept of human rights can be understood as one intimately linked with the concepts of fair treatment according to law and to the concept of equality. All human beings want to be treated fairly and would even rebel or resist if treated unfairly. They want their essential humanity to be recognized, not only in terms of their similarity with other human beings, but also in relation to their individuality, their own individual character and characteristics. They stand for their demands for equality and freedom. Equality and freedom are thus not incompatible. Furthermore, equality is a precondition for freedom. All forms of resistance, rebellion or revolution are only different forms of efforts to gain, retain or regain the human rights. For the weak, the resistance may take the shape of a suicide, while for the strong, this struggle may result in concrete historical events, like in the case of barons who extracted the Magna Carta from King John at Runnymede in the year 1215 AD, in order to restore the rights which they believed were their due. Other forms of resistance are mass rebellion, terrorist attacks, the refusal by soldiers to obey the orders of their officers, conspiracies, so on and so forth. Thus, the entire human activity in the direction of securing human activity is in the direction of securing human rights of equality and liberty, denied or curtailed by the state or the individual or a group of individuals. a universally accepted definition of the term human rights still eludes. In India, the Protection of Human Rights Act 1993 defines human rights as the rights relating to life, liberty, equality, and dignity of the individual guaranteed by the Constitution are embodied in the international covenants and enforceable by courts in India. They may be described as the claims asserted and recognized and enforced against society as represented by government and its officials. The concept of human rights falls generally within the framework of constitutional law and international law. For this purpose, it has been identified to defend by institutionalized means the rights of human beings against abuses of power committed by the organs of the state, and at the same time to promote the establishment of human living conditions and the multidimensional development of human personality. It can be seen that the human rights have evolved from natural rights. The appeal to equate natural rights with human rights is ordained in Vedas. The philosophy envisaged in Rig Veda commands that all human beings are equal and that the conduct is just, which is based on the principles of equality. Vedic ethics idealized an equality of treatment. Atharva Veda ordains that all human beings are equal and that the conduct is moral, which is based on the principles of equality. The philosophy of human rights appears to have its existence in the domain of natural law. According to the philosophy of natural law jurists, the natural law denotes natural justice, an instrument which can harmonize the whole mankind and bestow happiness essential for good living of a society. To the Greek philosophers like Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, natural law is both a way of living as well as thinking. Their philosophy has been that natural law enables a man to realize good life, that is, living according to virtue. Aristotle argues that the philosophy of human rights derives its strength from the principles of natural law. Sophists also focused on ethical and moral values to prepare the young men of Athens to be efficient citizens. Hugo Grotius had a strong conviction that natural law is binding one and overrules all other laws. They believed that natural law predicates men to recognize divine will in human affairs. Grotius observed that by the inclusion of natural law in a legal system, it becomes the link between the minds of men and the mind of God. The natural law contents in Hugo Grotius, Thomas Hobbes, John Locke, Rousseau, and Immanuel Kant strongly propagate the existence of human rights, securing of life, property, and happiness, and subjects by the social institutions. Thus, the principle of natural law hammers out a charter of human rights to be protected as the basis of survival of the human being. The crux of the natural law philosophy is that it makes the life, liberty, and property the cardinal rights of man, which greatly dominate the influences the future course of the developments of human rights philosophy the world over. Following are the most important characteristics of human rights that distinguish them from other rights. First and foremost, the human rights are inalienable. In other words, these rights are conferred on an individual due to the very nature of his existence. They are inherent in all the individuals, irrespective of their caste, creed, religion, sex, and nationality. Human rights are conferred on an individual even after his death. The different rituals in different religions bear testimony to this fact. Secondly, human rights are essential and necessary for protecting the human dignity. In the absence of human rights, the moral, physical, social and spiritual welfare of an individual is impossible. Human rights are also essential as they provide suitable conditions for material and moral attainment of the people. The Indian Supreme Court approvingly quoted on number of occasions that life means not mere animal existence, but the right to live with basic human dignity. Such a dignity comes with the enjoyment of human rights. They are essential to treat another individual with dignity, irrespective of the fact that the person is a male or female, rich or poor, so on and so forth. It is concerned with the human dignity. For instance, in 1993, Indian Parliament has enacted a law that forbids the practice of carrying human excreta. This law is called the Employment of Manual Scavengers and Dry Latrines Prohibition Act and is one of the many legislations enacted in India to protect human dignity. Thirdly, human rights are irrevocable in the sense that they cannot be taken away by any power or authority, because these rights originate with the social nature of man in the society of human beings, and they belong to a person simply because he is a human being. They are not given by the state as a charity to its citizens. Rather, they are born with such rights. As such, human rights are inalienable rights, that is, a set of human rights that are fundamental. They are not awarded by human power and cannot be surrendered. Fourthly, human rights are necessary for the fulfillment of the purpose of life. Everybody knows that human life has a purpose. The term human right is applied to those conditions which are essential for the fulfillment of this purpose. No government has the power to curtail or take away the human rights which are sacrosanct, inviolable and immutable. Fifthly, the human rights are universal. They are not a monopoly of any privileged class of people. Human rights are universal in nature, without consideration and without exception. The values such as divinity, dignity and equality, which form the basis of these rights, are inherent in human beings by nature. Thus, they are recognized and enforced throughout the world. Sixthly, human rights are never absolute. It is a well-known principle that no right is absolute. Same is the case with regard to the human rights. As the man is a social animal and he lives in a civic society, which always puts certain restrictions on the enjoyment of his rights and freedoms. Human rights are, as such, are those limited powers or claims which are contributory to the common good and which are recognized and guaranteed by the state, though it's lost to the individuals. As such, each right has certain limitations and exceptions. However, these limitations or restrictions can be imposed only in the larger interest of the humanity. Next, important characteristic of human rights is that they are dynamic. They are ever evolving. They don't remain static. They go on expanding with this socio, eco, cultural and political developments within the state. Judges have to interpret these laws in such ways as are in tune with the changed social values. For instance, the right to be cared for in sickness has now been extended to include free medical insurance in public hospitals under the public health scheme, free medical examination in schools, and the provisions for especially equipped schools for the physically handicapped. One can refer to a plethora of rights like the rights of children, women, displaced persons and transgenders to justify this statement. Eighthly, human rights constitute limits on the state power. Human rights imply that every individual has certain legitimate claims upon his or her society for certain freedoms and benefits. So, human rights limit the state's power. The late US Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes Jr. once reportedly observed, "The right to swing my fist ends where the other man's nose begins." Thus, the human rights are of one individual may be made subject to the human rights of others. These may be in the form of negative restrictions on the powers of the state from violating the inalienable freedoms of the individuals, or in the nature of demands on the state, that is, positive obligations of the state. For example, six freedoms that are enumerated under Article 19 of the Constitution of India and made available to the citizens of India forbid the state from interfering with the individuals, but they are also made subject to number of restrictions that can be imposed by the state. Thus, it could be seen that all human rights are inherent, universal, indivisible, interdependent, and related to each other. The human rights have evolved through a series of developments at the national and international level. The most important landmarks in the progress of human rights at international level are as under. First, there is a very famous Cyrus cylinder, which denotes a replica on which the king called Cyrus of ancient Persia had printed certain basic rights which are made available to the citizens of that particular country. It implies that he freed the slaves, declared that all people had the right to choose their own religion, and established racial equality. And in modern times, Cyrus cylinder appears to be the beginning of human rights. Next comes the most important development in the form of the Magna Carta of 1215, which is also known as the Great Charter, which was list of assurances given by King John III to the barons and the subjects. And some of the important rights that have been recognized by Magna Carta include the right not to be punished except for committing an offense, the right not to be seized of the property except as a punishment, and no taxation without Parliament's approval, so on and so forth. Next comes the English Bill of Rights, 1689. Everybody knows that glorious revolution took place in the year 1688 in England. It was a bloodless revolution, and immediately thereafter, in the year 1689, there was an English Bill of Rights. However, because of the emergence of parliamentary sovereignty in England, it could not take a proper shape, but it became the basis of Bill of Rights in United States of America later on. Another important landmark appears to be the US Declaration of Independence, 1776. The 13 British colonies in North America declared independence in the year 1776. On 4th July 1776, this declaration drafted by Thomas Jefferson is one of the most important declarations as far as the modern day human rights are concerned. Similarly, the same United States Constitution underwent the first 10 amendments in the year 1791, collectively called the Bill of Rights, and initially 12 amendments were suggested, out of which 10 amendments got carried through. Now, along with these first 10 amendments, 13th amendment, 14th amendment and the 15th amendment constitute the Bill of Rights in United States of America, which is a reflection of human rights protection in United States of America. This is followed by the French Declaration of the Rights of Man and of the Citizen in 1789. Similarly, the Declaration of International Rights of Man 1929 after the First World War, then again the UN Charter 1945. We have to remember that it is the Charter of the United Nations after the Second World War that recognized the fundamental human rights of all the citizens and nationals of the countries, and it called upon the member countries of the UN to protect the human rights of the citizens all over the world. It is followed by the Universal Declaration of Human Rights 1948, a non-binding declaration, but which is on the lines of the US Declaration of Independence 1776. It can be seen from the fact that this declaration boldly declares that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. Since this declaration is not a binding declaration, two important international covenants had to be signed in the year 1966. One is the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, and the other one is the International Covenant on Social, Cultural and Economic Rights. Both of them are binding on majority of the nations today, and they drive these member nations to protect the human rights in the proper perspective.